Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be loved by Rome, sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man, salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Good evening, everybody. This is Jock Lisman once again from YouTube channel Jockler66 with another episode on the 6th of August 2015 of Hour of the Truth. So, last week we went through almost the conclusion of the middle book that Ronald Cooke wrote, where Walt Stickel made the whole booklet from the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, and in a few moments I will continue reading the last about two pages to end this little booklet, but of course, or this little book that was worked into that booklet, but we are then of course having still some pages and some chapters in that booklet that Walt put together to read about. That will be for some other weeks, because today I have something that you probably read when you got your invitation. I have found a paper while studying a little bit the workings and the doings of Martin Luther that seemed to me very interesting to read to you, and thus we will do the latest and the second part of the show after the first 45 minutes. And that writing from Martin Luther is called An Open Letter to the Christian Nobility of the German Nation Concerning the Reform of the Christian Estate. And I will say more to that later when the time has come to read and talk about that. And I can assure you it is very interesting to read, to learn what Martin Luther had to say in 1520, which is almost 500 years, 495 years past exactly. And I can tell you, you only have to translate a part of that into our time, and you will see how foreseeing and how actually the times match together, how the times of 1520 are not that much of a difference to the time of 2015. One big difference there is, and that big difference is that this year, 5 weeks from now, or 6 weeks from now, whatever, 23rd of September, the Antichrist is coming to the Protestant nation of America. Anyway, Walt Stickel is with me tonight, like all the other evenings. He set the call up, and he's the one that I rely on to do this broadcast, and I love to do the broadcast together with him, because Walt is even dumb, as dumb as me. We are both just students of Christ. So Christ comes first, we come after that. But Walt, thank you very much for setting the call up, for being here, and to be my co-host today on Hour of the Truth. How are you doing over there in Rome, America?
Greetings and good evening, Belgium, and good morning, America. It's a sunny day here on the Oregon coast on the shores of America. Well, you know, some of the things you used the word Protestant, you mentioned the word Protestant, and I remember it's been about 5 years ago when I started listening and studying, doing some research on the word Protestant. And the first thing that I noticed is when I went out onto the streets and ask a common person what a Protestant was, they didn't know. And even to this day, it has been really, truth of it is, it has been vacuumed from the mind of what the true definition of a Protestant is, a Protestant. Now, this is a 1962 dictionary that says the prime definition is a member of one of those bodies of Christians that adhere to Protestantism. Well, that's pretty vague. That's pretty vague.
Yeah, you can definition. Say that, yeah.
What is a Protestant? You know, I started my webpage, thegranddesignexposed.com, on January 11th, 2011. And as time went on, I mean, I understood that the papacy, in 2011, I understood that the papacy was a big player in the New World Order and had been left out of my education. But as time has progressed now, probably if you go to my page, Grand Design Exposed, I want to give you a little study guide of how to get a knife, make sure you fully understand to start your study on futurism and what it's done to the evangelical world and to the Christian world. Now, the first place I'm going to take you to, the most important web link I have on my webpage, is you go down to button 8. Button 8 is called the Jesuit Diabolical New World Order. You click on that, and it takes you to a broadcast I did about 2 years ago. Tom Fress come on Mystery Babylon News Radio on Blog Talk and did 10 broadcasts. And he read out of a little pamphlet called The Origin of the Dispensationalism, Futurism, and Its Entry into Protestantism Christianity.
May I interrupt you there for a second, Walt?
Yes.
You gave me the link to these broadcasts, and I already put part one up on video on my YouTube channel, Juggler66. And I will upload all the other 9 parts so that we will have all the 10 parts on my YouTube channel, and you can check that out. I gave it the name New World Order 101.
That's a good, very good. That's just where I'm going, because to understand the New World Order, you got to start here. You got it. In other words, it's broad. I was just, you know, it goes all the way back to the first pope came out of Babylon. Okay, but the papacy today is Rome, the Roman Catholic Church. The papacy is the Antichrist. And so after you listen to these 10, and he's going to have them up, York's putting them up on his, then I want you to go back to Grand Design Exposed And I want you to go up and listen to Dispelling Futurism. Now, after you have got the round picture of it, I want you to listen to the last six broadcasts that Tom did. Now, there's a reason for why I'm setting this up this way. Then after you've done that, then I only know of one other author, and I'm, you know, there are other sources, but it's limited, that are debunking the rapture. There's a book written by Nicholas Arthur. It's called The Rapture Will Be Canceled.
I applaud you for that, for bringing that up. That's a very important and interesting book. Yeah.
Yes, but after you listen to the Diabolical New World Order, and you listen to this dispensational futurism, and explain, Tom goes over piece by piece by piece. Now you understand what the evangelical world is teaching. In this world, it is said that there are 1.2 billion Catholics in this, Roman Catholics in this country, in this world. But listen, if you add the evangelicals with them, because they're all Catholic.
They're universal, absolutely. They're absolutely universal.
They're universalist. Now, there's a, and you, because why, how do I say this? Remember, this is the hour of the truth, and if I say something that's out of line or it's not factual, I need to be refuted. But you see, it was Ribera in 1590 that wrote a 500-page book. And you will find this history on Tom Fress's presentation of these 10 broadcasts. You'll find the history of how futurism got started. It's because we started out with the word, and we're going to be talking about Martin Luther. But the word Protestant, what were they protesting? See?
Can I intervene here?
Yes.
I just took the Webster's Dictionary from 1828 and look up the word Protestant. And there are two definitions of the word Protestant. The first one is that it's an adjective pertaining to those who, at the Reformation of religion, protested against the decree of Charles V and the Diet of Spires, pertaining to the adherents of Luther or others of the Reformed churches as the Protestant religion. And we already spoke on earlier broadcasts on the, what's it called here, the Diet of Spires that happened in 1529, where the word Protestant actually for the first time came up. So in the former years of Martin Luther's work, even translating the Bible, nobody spoke about a Protestant. That came about in 1529, and you can look that up when you do a Google search or whatever in your search engine, and you look up the Diet of Spires 1529, then you will understand where the word Protestant comes from. And the second explanation that Webster's Dictionary of 1828 gives us, and very important, choose the 1828 because the newer ones are corrupted, like all the other newer writings. The second explanation of Protestant is a noun, explaining that one of the party who adhered to Luther at the Reformation in 1529 and protested or made a solemn declaration of dissent from a decree from the of the Emperor Charles V and the Diet of Spires, and appealed to a general council. This name was afterwards extended to the followers of Calvin, and Protestants is the denominations now given to all who belong to the Reformed churches. The King of Prussia has, however, interdicted the use of this name in his dominions. Why did he do that? Well, you can look that up in history, because the King of Prussia was, next to the Tsar of Russia, the only person who gave refuge to the Jesuits in the time that they were, by a papal bull, thrown out of the Vatican and thrown out of 73 countries of this world in 1773 until their restoration in 1814. Prussia and Russia, these two, gave refuge to the Jesuits at that time. But please, Walt, continue on for a short moment that we can go on to the book of the of Cooke and finish that. But please continue now.
Well, this is what has led me to collect. I learned how to put information in book form with Open Office and make a PDF file, and I learned how to publish a book. What I'm going to do, and I started yesterday, is put a book together to bring us up to 2015 and show how this futurism got started. I mean, it has redefined stupid in evangelical churches. It has redefined stupid. And what futurism has done solely by its, because where is our position here on Hour of the Truth? Where ours is a biblical. It's biblical. We are in the company of Luther, Calvin, Knox, Cramer, Spurgeon, Henry Grattan, Guinness. Single-handed, the evangelical, when you piece this history together, and the reason I'm taking some time is because we all learn in waves. We have not arrived. And the more I am exposed to futurism and what it's done historically and what it's done to America and what it's done to the world, I'm going to give you a quick example. People are focused on what's going on in Israel. They're focused. Rick Wiles, John MacArthur, all the men that write these Nephilim books, now they're writing books, and there's some credibility. I'm not trying to just push everything away. But what this is John MacArthur, Rick Wiles, and John Hagee. I could make a list, a book of these men. Why are they teaching futurism? They're talking, you see what's going on in Israel right now is a red herring. It's a distraction. We know who the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist is. But by us, and when you look at who started futurism, Francisco Ribera, and there's more than him. It was Bellarmine, Lacunza that brought in dispensation, and then it was Darby. You'll get all this information when you listen to those broadcasts I told you to listen to. And then you can go to historis.com. Historis.com has some good articles. But what I'm trying to say is, we are either wrong on the Hour of the Truth, and if we're wrong, that means that Calvin was wrong, Luther was wrong, Spurgeon was wrong, Henry Grattan Guinness was wrong.
Calvin was wrong, Wycliffe was wrong, Tyndale was wrong, Zwingli was wrong, Melanchthon was wrong.
And if that is the case, if we are in error here on Hour of the Truth, we owe the Pope an apology. But I want you to say straight up, you see, the brothers and sisters and the listeners to this broadcast know who the Antichrist is. And what's going on in Israel is a distraction. It's been all orchestrated by the Vatican. Zionism is a creation of the Jesuits. And what they're doing over there, and you can listen to Rick Wiles, and you can listen to John MacArthur. And John MacArthur is the slickest one of them all. Because he will give a lot of history, a lot of things, and talk about Rome. But at the end of his talk, I heard it with my own words. And Antichrist, in the end times, it could even be the papacy. So why, this is very important to get our minds right when we start reading some of, later on in this broadcast, when we start reading some of Luther's work. And what a real Protestant is. And we're living in some perilous times because we got a Jesuit pope speaking on the 23rd in another month. In the meantime, they're haggling about what's going on in Israel. And they're talking about sodomy and same-sex marriage. You think that that wasn't passed at a right time to keep people distracted off what's really happening? That is a big, big distraction. And it's amazing of how they completely turned the Reformation around with futurism. Futurism is counter-reformation, and we have a Jesuit pope coming, and anybody that has done any research knows solely why the Jesuits were formed to counter the Reformation. How can they bring a Jesuit pope over here to speak to a joint session of Congress?
That's very easy explained.
Because I'm going to ask this question to you. I was talking to York last week in a conversation. And I said, when you were going to school, York is German. He's heritage. He's a full-blooded German. And he went to school in German schools. And I asked York, and I'm going to ask you, York, and you answer it. What did they teach you about the Inquisition in the Dark Ages?
Well, the way that they taught the Inquisition in that time was that they placed the Roman Catholic Church, the Inquisitor, as the good guys, and all the so-called heretics and witches and I don't know what all names they gave to them, they were the bad guys. So the people who really believed in the word of God, those were the bad guys in the way that they taught the Inquisition in German schools when I went to that school. And I went to school in Hamburg, and in a part of Hamburg, even that is not Hamburg, but that is actually Prussia, Blankenese. That's where I went. That's where I was born. That's a little suburb outside of Hamburg, on the outskirts of Hamburg, let's say, not outside of Hamburg, but on the outskirts. And that actually belonged to a community called Altona. And Altona and everything west from it belonged still to Prussia and not to the city of Hamburg. So that gives you an idea what they taught there, because that was actually a Protestant high place, considering that in Middle Germany, like Nordrhein-Westfalen, the strike of Cologne and Frankfurt and all those cities, and south of that, where you had more Catholic influence, you would say, okay, there it's logical to teach other way. No, they even taught that in our so-called Protestant North German area. We all had to go back under the wings of Rome, and that was in that teaching. Yeah.
And also in that course of that conversation, you said there isn't one lick of Protestantism in Germany.
today.
If you go to today, this has been, they are even changing street names with the word Luther on them.
Street names, names of places and all that stuff which bear the name of Luther are today revised and given other names, yeah.
And that, briefly, is reason why we had an East Germany and a West Germany after the war. The East Germany was predominantly Protestant, and they turned the communists on them for 25 years. And if you go up to Wittenberg, where Luther, I learned this from Walter Weiss on Rekindling the Reformation. If you go to the church
the church, when you go to the Wartburg, that is the castle where he translated the Bible, when you're going to visit that today and you're going to take a tour, then you will not be shown the room where Luther sat and translated the Bible when he sat there as Junker Jörg, as he was disguised for safety reasons in that time. They will only talk about a Princess of Elizabeth, who, of course, was a Catholic, and tell you all the wonderful things that she did there. And Luther is not even mentioned. And you cannot even see the room on the normal tour where Luther lived and translated the Bible. That's what they're doing. Yeah.
And so what I realized when York said they have completely stamped out Protestantism, and it's pretty much the same way here, except people, a lot of Americans don't understand their heritage, but there's still a flicker. There's a flicker. This country is covered with churches. This country is. And at one time, they knew what a Protestant was. But in the days that we live in, that's why I said earlier, I mean, it's like when futurism, see, futurism has only been around for about 175 years. It took about 175 years to come blanket every evangelical church. And how did they do this? They did it through the seminaries and the Bible colleges. Every single one teaches futurism. And like I said before, and I'm going to close here, if we are in error here, we owe an apology. Luther and all the reformers need to apologize to the papacy. But the seed that's here on Hour of the Truth, and everyone that's listening here, we've been hit by the same wave. We learn in waves. I was talking to a listener the other day, and you know, he was a little angry. Well, that's part of waking up.
Yeah, that's part of waking up.
But in other words, once you see what they have done right in front of us. This country is divided up into 195 dioceses. It started out in 1776, in 1789, they had five. The shadow government in the United States, what other denomination has carved up this country in 195 regions? And it's divided up into 10 provinces of the Jesuits. And FEMA is divided up into 10 regions. Now, anyway, this is why it's important, some of the work, to understand, we'll understand some of Luther's work when we read it later on in this broadcast. So that's what I had to say for this morning.
Okay, Walt, thank you very much for your introduction. And I just want to finish this little subject that you put in here. by repeating that I will be uploading all the 10 parts of Tom's reading on my YouTube channel, Juggler66. The first one is already out there. It's called New World Order 101, Part 1. And the other ones will have the same name, each according to its part that it is. And you can follow that there, or you can go to the website Grand Design Exposed and check the buttons that he has on the left side of his page, and go to the eighth point and click on that, and you can there listen for it for yourself if you don't want to wait for the videos. It's all out there already. But now I want to continue reading the last two pages on the conclusion that Ronald Cooke wrote in 1985 on his book on the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, not the complete booklet that Walt put together, but the first 55 pages that were the basis for Walt to put this booklet together. I am now on page 57, and we have read already the first and the second paragraph, I think, even the third, but I will start on the top of the page, and that right now. The enduring nature of Romanism is a sign that it is a devil-inspired conspiracy in a unique sense. After some of the most cruel atrocities of history, combined with the gross immoralities which have been part and parcel of the whole system, it has still managed not only to survive, but even to grow. Cardinal Manning said, quote, "The Catholic Church is either the masterpiece of Satan or the kingdom of God," unquote. Cardinal Newman declared, quote, "Either the Church of Rome is the house of God or the house of Satan," unquote. According then to two of its most famous representatives, our choices are very limited as to the origin and nature of Romanism. It is either God, of God, or it is of Satan. To the Bible-believing Protestant, God is holy and his church is also holy. When the origins of the Roman Catholic Church are examined, they point to Satan rather than to Christ. Martin, in his book, The Rise and Fall of the Roman Church, speaks of the method used in electing popes. Quote, "Vicious enmities were created, blood was shed, lives were taken." He goes even on to say, "At the election of Pope Damasus I in AD 366, 37 corpses littered the environs of the Liberian Basilica after a fracas between the followers of Damasus and his arch-rival Yersinius," unquote. He goes into much greater detail on and tells about Pope Stephen bringing his arch-rival before him with his kneecaps broken, his body whipped, and his eyes carved out. He further elaborates, quote, "Within a year, Pope Stephen will have used Duke Desiderius to get Christophorus, Sergius, and Gratius imprisoned, with first their eyes cut out, then their lives ended. He then will turn on Desiderius, and by December of 771 will encompass his ruin and death," unquote. Now, Martin again, and as far as I understand it, this is still Malachi Martin, right, Walt?
Right.
That's a quote from Malachi Martin here, okay? Mm-hmm. Quote, "The high point in Marzoia's career came after the end of her very long life when she was visited in her Roman prison by an emperor who had just seized possession of the city, Otto III, a successor of Charlemagne. He had only one reason for visiting Marzoia, to lay his eyes on the woman who was the mother of a pope whom she had conceived by another pope, and who was the aunt of a third pope, the grandmother of a fourth pope, and with the help of her own mother, the creator of 9 popes in 8 years, of whom 2 had been strangled, 1 suffocated with a cushion, and 4 deposed and disposed of in circumstances that have never come to public light," unquote. Now there's a very interesting thing that we read right here, and that's the point here. The Roman Catholic Church wants you to believe that their popes are there because of apostolic succession. Now, only if you read this little paragraph that I just read to you, he wants to lay the eyes on the woman who was the mother of a pope, who was the aunt of a third pope, She had conceived another pope, was the aunt of a third pope, the grandmother of a fourth, and would help her own mother, the creator of 9 popes in 8 years. Are we talking about apostolic succession here? Really? Roman Catholics, please come out of her, my people. It's the church of Satan. It has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. It has nothing to do with apostolic succession, which doesn't even exist. And the Roman Catholic Church was not built on Peter, but on the faith Peter had. Okay, continue reading, so you have something to think about in the meantime. So reads the pages of Martin's book. Martin still believes in the Roman Catholic Church, but we ask the question, how could anyone believe that the Roman cult is the kingdom of God after reading this book and after studying church history? It is absolutely inconceivable that the Holy Spirit of truth has been connected with such atrocities, crimes, errors, and intrigues for centuries. It's a spiritual and moral impossibility. I would say the Roman Catholic Church is a spiritual cesspool. Nevertheless,
also it's the Walmart of paganism.
That's a good one, yeah. Nevertheless, the Vatican has always shown great resiliency and adaptability in keeping abreast of national and international changes. It is working tirelessly toward one goal, to bring the entire world to the feet of the Roman Pontiff. The methods used to achieve this goal have included and do include, as we have seen above, murder, massacre, Marxism, propaganda, ironic dialogue, revolution, repression, assassination, education, kindness, coercion, brotherhood, charity, monasticism, enforced celibacy, Jesuit casuistry, intrigue, financial threats, and chicanery, and last but certainly not least, a global conspiracy with an historical continuity, and local henchmen to see that it continues to endure, unsurpassed in the annals of recorded history. The ends justify the means is no empty slogan, but the modus operandi of the global aspirations of the Jesuits and the Vatican. As the final stages of the great satanic religious conspiracy break upon the world, Bible believers need to watch their religious affiliation and fellowship. According to Revelation 18, verse 4, some of God's people are mixed up in the end-time unholy amalgam of Rome's harlot religion and the One World Church. The word says, come out of her, my people, let you be not partaker of her sins, and receive not of her plagues. The One World Church, which will be dominated by Rome and ruled over by the Pope, is looming at the horizon. It may be years before we see the full-orbed picture of Mystery Babylon, the Great in its final form, but every true Bible believer in every generation stands against the Roman Catholic institution, for he sees in it all the seeds of the final apostate conglomerate, which is described in Revelation chapter 17 through 19. This ends the reading, and I just want to say, I just watched a video with my mother during dinner this evening, a video from Walter Veit about the introduction of Revelation, and that is what they say about the Revelation. They, the Roman Catholic Church, you will never understand the book of Revelation. You are too dumb to understand it, and anyway, what's written in Revelation is whether already past time or will be in some future time where nobody who is in the world right now will be infected on. That is what the Roman Catholic Church teaches. The Roman Catholic Church does not want you to read the book of Revelation as the Jews, and I mean when saying the Jews, I'm speaking about the rabbis, I'm speaking about the Pharisees, I'm speaking about the scribes, don't want the Jews to read the book of Daniel. And there is a very interesting quote in that video from Walter Veit. I can't get it right now, but it's like something, your hand and your bones shall be rotten of the person who opens the book of Daniel. Why? Because the book of Daniel in chapter 9, verses 24 to 27, tells everybody exactly at what time in world history Jesus Christ the Messiah will come. And that's why the Jews were forbidden to read the book of Daniel. And that's why they didn't know the time of their visitation. And not all of the Jews, there were a few who knew it, and those were the ones who followed Jesus Christ. But most of them, 99.9% probably, had no idea. And that's why they still continue in their apostasy, because they do not know the true word of God. As for us, luckily, it is preserved in the 1611 King James Bible. That is where we get our authority on this broadcast from, and that's where we build our authority on everything that we read and that we try to bring the knowledge to the people. The basis of our teachings is the Bible, the King James Bible from 1611, and no other one. And you can write 1, 5, 10, 20, or 100 comments against it, I don't care. Because the more you attack that Bible, the more I know I've chosen the right word of God. Okay, Walt, are there any concluding remarks that you want to say after that, what I just read? That would be very nice. Yeah, then take over for a moment. Okay.
Revelation 17:5. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Cardinal Gibbons, he was a cardinal during the era in Baltimore, during the time of the Civil War. Cardinal Gibbons stated on page 106 of Faith of Our Fathers in 1917 edition. Now listen, this comes from a Catholic cardinal. The penetration of the religion of Babylon became so general and well known that Rome was called the New Babylon. It's the biggest show on earth, the biggest fraud that's ever been put on man. And you know, I had a little short conversation with a friend this morning, just before I went on the broadcast, and you know. The papacy, the Antichrist, the man of sin, you know, it goes all the way back to Babylon. And Daniel, the king that Daniel was serving. How do you say his name?
Nebuchadnezzar?
Yes. He was a pope. He required worship.
Isn't it interesting that the kind of spaceship they use in the movie The Matrix is called the Nebuchadnezzar?
they can get away with this stuff.
Because people don't know history. Yeah?
People don't know history and haven't been reading their Bible. And another thing that was brought up, that I was having a conversation with this fellow this morning. They've got to ask everybody believing that you have to listen to somebody that's been to a Bible college or a seminary. So when you go in to these churches, you check your brains and your Bible at the door. And listen, people that have, and I'm noticing this, I've been listening to several people this last week, and when they're reading their Bible, they know what's going on. And the more they read the Bible sometimes, and they realize that, you know, and we should, this is one thing that gets all of us, I think, is we realize that we're the minority, okay? The majority are going to and listening to ministers that have been taught in seminaries and Bible colleges, and they've all been infiltrated. Every single seminary and Bible college is counter-reformation. They're countering the Reformation. And here we stand today in August, a month before the man of sin, the son of perdition, is coming to speak to a joint session of Congress. And people, you know, are are talking about same-sex marriage. You know, I mean, this is another definition of the word stupid. You know, they're stuck. I heard somebody say this to me this last week. They're stuck on stupid. You know, they actually, it's to Ignatius Loyola's spirituality and exercises, they have literally stopped a thinking mind. In other words, when somebody goes to a Bible college, there's nobody in this call that could go. I could not go to a Bible college, sit down, and first of all, I have to find out what Bible they're teaching out of. And in most cases, everybody in the class would have a different Bible. You know, I mean, when we understand this is what this call is about. The people on this call here, they're researchers, people that are wide awake. And what they need, you need to hear, you're not the only ones. I know what's going through. I mean, because every place we go, if you walked into a church, let me just read a page that was written, a little short paragraph.
It is called An Open Letter to the Christian Nobility of the German Nation Concerning the Reform of the Christian Estate of 1520. This is adapted from the translation of C.M. Jacobs' Works of Luther in Philadelphia, 1915, and found online at a website that I can provide to you, because it's in this PDF in there, and it's very interesting. So, well, I'm going to do the reading of this, and it is seven double pages, so I don't know if we get all through it today. If not, we will continue next week for sure. But I want to ask you to just say comment when there is something that you have to say, and then we can discuss this a little bit. And I guess that you, Walt, and all our listeners here and all our viewers of the video later on will see how actually this was written almost 500 years ago and is still very, very up to date. The three walls of the Romanists. The Romanists, and that term is explained here, the Romanists, the term Romanist is applied by Luther to the champions of the extreme form of papal supremacy. And that was even before the Jesuits were there. The Romanists, with great adroitness, have built three walls about them, behind which they have hitherto defended themselves in such wise that no one has been able to reform them. And this has been the cause of terrible corruption throughout all Christendom. First, when pressed by the temporal power, they have made decrees and said that the temporal power has no jurisdiction over them, but, on the other hand, that the spiritual is above the temporal power. Second, when the attempt is made to reprove them out of the scriptures, they raise the objection that the interpretation of the scriptures belong to no one except the Pope. Third, if threatened with a council, they answer with the fable that no one can call a council but the Pope. In this wise, they have slyly stolen from us our three rods, that they may go unpunished and have encensored themselves within the safe stronghold of these three walls, that they may practice all the knavery and wickedness which we now see. Even when they have been compelled to hold a council, they have weakened its power in advance by previously binding the princes with an oath to let them remain as they are. Moreover, they have given the Pope full authority over all decisions of the council, so that it is all one whether there are many councils or no councils, except that they deceive us with puppet shows and sham battles. So terribly do they fear for their skin in a really free council, and they have intimidated kings and princes by making them believe it would be an offense against God not to obey them in all these nevish and crafty deceptions. So I have to stop here and fill something in. Luther is saying that there will be no council because only the Pope can call for it. And if there is a council, it's nothing to do anyway, because he got all the princes bind by oath to vote as he wants to. Now, interesting, the next council that came up was the Council of Trent in 1545, after the founding of the Counter-Reformation Jesuit Order. But I continue reading now. But let that work a little bit in your brain.
Comment?
Yeah, please, Wolf.
I just want to comment on that, what Luther said, except that they deceive us with puppet shows and sham battles.
Yeah.
Luther wrote that. He had no idea that Obama was going to be a president, that they're going to, you know, the whole presidency. And I'm 71 years old, and, you know, the last Protestant president we had was JFK. He might have been Catholic on paper, but he was not a Catholic. I mean, he was Protestant. He was Protestant, and he knew, you know, he was, even in his biography, he was said that he wasn't a good Catholic. You know, but the point of it is, look at the puppet show. Look what they've done to the presidency of the United States. I mean, we had 8 years of Bill Clinton, you know, our first sodomite couple as president. Because, listen, I'm going to tell you something about sodomy. Any abnormal sex is sodomy. Okay. Then we had 8 years of Showtime, Saturday Night Live with Bush. Now listen, Bush was not as stupid as he acted. The stupidity that he acted was all acting. I seen when he was running a video when he was running for governor in Texas. That man could speak. He didn't stutter. He pronounced his words. Now, we had 8 years of Bush. And I said, they can't get worse. It can't get any worse. And they elected. They elected Barack Hussein Obama. And during his election, they wouldn't even let the press say Hussein. Now, they got everybody believing he's a Muslim, talking Muslim. He's got a Muslim name. But, you know, when he ran for president, he ran as a Christian. This is what Martin Luther is talking about, is a puppet show.
Yeah, and the puppet show he talked about even before the Jesuits were there, who invented the Ratio Studiorum, which is the puppet show they play before all the people today, with Hollywood movies, television, and everything else.
And the Jesuits are the ones that invented the magic lantern.
Yeah.
You know, and everybody's thinking that Jews run Hollywood. The Jews run Hollywood. When is the last time you've seen something anti-Catholic come out of Hollywood? You know, you always, some way, somehow, a cross or a crucifix or something comes up in a movie. The subliminal. It's the Jesuits control Hollywood. They control the theater. They control. You know, when you watch the nightly news, you're watching Ignatius Loyola's spirituality. There's no reality in it. They're making this. They look back at our history. The fact that we got this many listeners in here, and everyone, I'd say something for every one of these listeners. They're sane. To listen to Fox News 5 days a week. Now, and listen, and there are people in this country, that's where they get their political view, is off Fox News. To watch Fox News 5 days a week, you're going to be insane.
It's like one of the former American presidents said, I don't have the quote right in front of me, but he said the man who doesn't read anything is more educated than the person who reads daily his newspaper.
Absolutely. So that really sticks out. Here Luther talking about a puppet shows and sham battles. I mean, listen, Luther, you see, the gospel of Jesus Christ, let me just intersect this right now. The gospel of Jesus Christ can be said in a, and don't take this wrong, but when you read the gospel, God says that you put your pants on one leg at a time, just like Caesar, you see, and see that Pope, you know, he's God. He's the vicar of Christ. But yet he goes around in a bulletproof Pope mobile. I mean, their God, they have to put in a bulletproof Pope mobile with bodyguards.
It's a poor God that needs protection, right?
Yeah, I mean, when you see this, now you understand and some people like to it. Now, people like to attack and get off on him and start attacking Luther because he was anti-Jewish, or on and on, or they go after Calvin, they attack Calvinism, and look what these men brought us out of. They were coming out of the Dark Ages.
I just wanted to say that brought light back into the world.
They brought, and these men, Martin Luther and these reformers, were all former Catholics.
There was no other church you could belong to at that time.
No, and there was a roll call. I mean, if you didn't show up at church, there was a knock on your door. People go, and how many places? How many people talk? Listen, York just told you earlier in the broadcast that he was taught about the Inquisition. I wasn't taught anything about the Inquisition. I didn't learn anything about the Inquisition until I was about 57 or 58 years old when I got a hold of Fox's Book of Martyrs. And I told this story many times. I shared it with a fellow truck driver, and he said, "Oh, Walt, that never happened." I said, "Well, go to the library, Bob." And he did. He went to the library. He said, "You know, Walt, you're right. That's what... If we don't talk about it, you forget about it. Things that aren't talked about are forgot about." Here Walt, 71 years old, raised in a Lutheran church, and never learned anything about the Reformation. It was just another church. And now Roman Catholicism is considered just another Christian denomination. Wasn't that way prior to 1776? They didn't allow them to hold office, and they didn't allow them to say to bring Christ out in the mass. Can you think of anything as what an abomination? Read the sacrifice, being able to think that their gods, that they can turn a cookie and wine into the blood of Jesus Christ and blood? That sounds like it's prehistoric. That's the reason why this country is the way it is, and why we still have some Americans, and the little bit of Americanism came from the Reformation and came from the cross. The little bit of freedom that we're expressing, and listen, we're close to having this all shut off. The fact that we're able to make a broadcast, you don't think that we're on a list? Ain't no place to hide. You don't think we're on a list? And you don't think they can take this away from us tomorrow? But as long as we got it, like Luther said, the time for silence is gone. The time to speak has come.
Right now.
Right now. Martin Luther. And that's what we're doing. That's what I had to say. Sometimes you get a little when you see how crazy this is.
You get angry when you read all these lies, you know? You get so angry, not at the lies per se, but you get so angry at the ignorance of the people today that they believe these lies without questioning. That's what makes me mad, not at the person itself, but at the ignorance that has been implanted into the people from cradle to grave, because the Jesuits and the state, by that way, takes care of the children from 2 years' age on. People give their children into cribs, into daycare, into kindergarten, into preschool, then into public school, into public schools, then into high schools, into universities, seminaries, and all that stuff to gain wisdom of the world, and they have no idea of the Word of God anymore. And this is just frustrating when you are on the other side and you see that.
And we don't need a priest to interpretate the Bible. We don't need a priest that graduates out of a Bible college, because these ministers that are futurists, you know, there's good men out here. I'm not trying to, you know, but in other words, it's time to speak. Rick Wiles, it's time to speak.
For Rick Wiles, it's time to listen.
You know. But these, in other words, they can't speak because of their meal ticket. They sell. Listen. Do you realize what happened if John Hagee, let's say John Hagee came out and started saying, he did one time, Hagee did make some comments about the Pope, but you can go up there on the internet and he wrote a nice 2-page apology.
A refutal.
Pope, okay?
Yeah.
I mean, you know. I mean,
he did that. What Luther denied to do when he stood there.
That's
in
1521. That's the difference between Martin Luther
and
Warren.
Here I stand, and I can do no other. That's what he should have done too. But he was probably only lukewarm, as Jesus called people like him.
You see, the truth stands by itself. It doesn't need somebody to hold it up.
The truth does not fear investigation, Walt.
No.
Only the lie fears that.
That's right.
You can investigate the truth as much as you want. You will only come to the truth. But when you open up the book of lies, you will only find lies and lies and lies and lies.
And you know, as we continue with this article, remember, as we read this article, this was written 500 years ago, and it's just as pertinent today as it was 500 years ago.
That's my point. It's absolutely to the date.
That's right. It's 500 years. You see, that's what, can you imagine coming out of the Dark Ages? And you see, it exploded. It exploded. I mean, after I met York, you know, I didn't realize, and most people listening today, maybe you're the same way. I didn't realize Poland was once Protestant. It's a Catholic nation today, but Poland used to be Protestant.
They turned Poland around within 60 years. And if you want to get to know a little bit more about that, then I advise you to go to the archives of granddesignexposed.com, where there is also a button on the left side, and that is called The Jesuits Derouting the Reformation. And those were 7 broadcasts Walt and I did more than a year ago about that exact fact.
Matter of fact, when we did those broadcasts, I had to kind of take a time out when I started to see exactly what happened to Germany. And
it was disturbing.
Very disturbing to see. In other words, what happened in World War I and II, briefly, was the Second 30-Year War. That's what happened to Germany, you know. Yeah. And there was a German Holocaust.
Are the 3 countries in this world at that time that upheld Protestantism? Russia, Germany, and the United States of America. So what better to incite these 3 nations in a worldwide war?
Don't forget England, too.
What?
Don't forget England. England
at that time, England wasn't that Protestant anymore.
Well, but they're still Protestants. They're just as ignorant as the Americans. But in other words, when they got that war started, it was to kill as many is to annihilate the Protestant Reformation.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that.
In other words, see, there's Inquisition. The Inquisition's just turned to war.
Yeah, it's like it's stated in our song that I always play before these broadcasts. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. That's why that is the motto of Hour of the Truth. Times and methods may have changed, the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of God, true Bible-believing people who uphold the truth in Jesus Christ's name. I didn't read that. I know that by heart by now. Anyway, Walt, okay, I'm going to continue reading, because otherwise we are still tomorrow here, because there's so much to say about this, but we have to give the people a little bit of credit to think for themselves, too. So I'm going to continue, okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And this is a very important paragraph I'm going to read right now. Here it goes. Now, God help us, and give us one of the trumpets with which the walls of Jericho were overthrown, that we may blow down these walls of straw and paper, and may set free the Christian rods for the punishment of sin, bringing to light the craft and deceit of the devil, to the end that through punishment we may reform ourselves, and once more attain God's favor. That was a very powerful paragraph. But it continues reading, against the first wall, we will direct our first attack. So you remember, there were three walls. And against the first wall, we will direct our first attack. It is pure invention that Pope, bishops, priests, and monks are to be called the quote-unquote spiritual estate. Princes, lords, artisans, and farmers, the temporal state. That is indeed a fine bit of lying and hypocrisy. Yet no one should be frightened by it. And for this reason, that all the Christians are truly the spiritual estate, and there is among them no difference at all but that of office, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 12, we are all one body, yet every member has its own work, whereby it serves every other, all because we have one baptism, one gospel, one faith, and are all alike Christians. For baptism, gospel, and faith alone make us spiritual and a Christian people. But that the Pope or a bishop anoints, confers tonsures, ordains, consecrates, or prescribes dress unlike that of the laity, but that a pope or a bishop anoints, confers tonsures, ordains, consecrates, or prescribes dress unlike that of the laity, this may make hypocrites and graven images, but it never makes a Christian or spiritual man. Through baptism, all of us are consecrated to the priesthood, as Peter says in 1 Peter 2, verse 9, quote, ye are a royal priesthood, a priestly kingdom, unquote. And the book of Revelation says in Revelation 5, verse 10, quote, thou hast made us by thy blood to be priests and kings, unquote. For if we had no higher consecration than pope or bishop gives, the consecration by pope or bishop would never make a priest, nor might anyone either say mass or preach a sermon or give absolution. Therefore, when the bishop consecrates, it is the same thing as if he, in the place and stead of the whole congregation, all of whom have like power, were to take one out of their number and charge him to use this power for the others. Just as though 10 brothers, all kings' sons and equal heirs, were to choose one of themselves to rule the inheritance for them all. They would all be kings and equal in power, though one of them would be charged with the duty of ruling. Walt, can you maybe mute your mic when you are not doing anything, because you have some interrupting noise there, okay?
Okay.
Thank you, brother. To make it still clearer, if a little group of pious Christians, laymen, were taken captive and set down in a wilderness, and had among them no priest consecrated by a bishop, and if there in the wilderness they were to agree in choosing one of themselves, married or unmarried, and were to charge him with the office of baptizing, saying mass, absolving and preaching, such a man would be as truly a priest as though all bishops and popes had consecrated him. That is why, in cases of necessity, anyone can baptize and give absolution, which would be impossible unless we were all priests. This great grace and power of baptism and of the Christian estate they have well nigh destroyed, and caused us to forget through the canon law. It was in the matter, in the manner aforesaid that Christians in olden days chose from their number bishops and priests who were afterwards confirmed by other bishops, without all the show which now obtains. It was thus that Saints Augustine, Ambrose, and Cyprian became bishops. Now, it's a little bit an explanation about the canon law that I want to give to you, that was mentioned in the sentence before. This great grace and power of baptism and of the Christian estate they have well nigh destroyed and caused us to forget through the canon law. What is canon law? The canon law, called by Luther throughout his treatise and elsewhere the quote-unquote spiritual law, is a general name for the decrees of councils and decisions of the popes, promulgated by authority of the popes. It comprised the whole body of church law and embodied in legal forms the medieval theory of papal absolutism, which accounts for the bitterness with which Luther speaks of it, especially in this treatise. I'm going to continue reading now in the open letter to the Christian nobility. Since, then, the temporal authorities are baptized with the same baptism and have the same faith and gospel as we must grant that they are priests and bishops and count their office on which has one which has a proper and useful place in the Christian community. For whosoever comes out of the water of baptism can boast that he is already consecrated priest, bishop, and pope, though it is not seemly that everyone should exercise the office. Nay, just because we are all in like manner priests, no one must put himself forward and undertake without our consent and election to do what is in the power of all of us. For what is common to all, no one dare take upon himself without the will and the command of the community. And should it happen that one chosen for such an office were deposed for malfeasance, he would then be just what he was before he held office. Therefore, a priest in Christendom is nothing else than an office holder. While he is in office, he has precedence. When deposed, he is a peasant or a townsman, like the rest. Beyond all doubt, then, a priest is no longer a priest when he is deposed. But now they have invented characters indelibilis. And this means the character indelibilis, or indelible mark, received authoritative statement in the bull Exultate Deo from 1439. Quote, among these sacraments there are three, baptism, confirmation, and orders, which indelibly impress upon the soul of character, i.e. a certain spiritual mark, which distinguishes them from the rest. Unquote.
Now, York, can you explain a little bit canon law, and how it? How it has crept into civil law? How it creeps into civil law?
I'm not sure that I understand what you mean by that. No, Walt.
Well, canon law, like the Patriot Act in America, when they passed the Patriot Act after 9/11.
Yeah, they passed all kinds of laws that do not that go around the Constitution, and all these laws, like the executive orders that Obama releases almost every day, have nothing to do with the Constitution and have nothing to do with the Protestant basis America was built on. But it has all to do with canon law. And by putting in the Supreme Court of the nine justices, six Catholics and three Jews, they make sure that there is no foundation of the Bible left in the law-giving of the United States of America. Because otherwise it would be based more or less on the Constitution, which is more or less based on the Bible. I say more or less, you know, you have to be very careful when you say that, but that is all based on canon law, church law, which is, of course, the melting of church and state, so that the spiritual will be the dominator of the secular, which is one of the three walls that we were talking here about. This is how I could explain it, if that's
in other words, too, the executive laws and the laws that were passed in the Patriot Act, you know, is Roman canon law, because it doesn't pertain to the Constitution in the United States.
Absolutely, it is to undermine the Constitution, and this is why people like George W. Bush even said that the Constitution is a BS piece of paper, which should be get rid of.
Right, right. In other words, that's how they infiltrate civil law. And of course, now,
canon law makes normal civil law or the constitutional law void. That's the point. And because there is no watchman anymore in the United States, like when you have 9 Supreme Courts and no one is Protestant, then of course you have no one who is controlling the government anymore. There's no control. You have a government gone wild because the people don't care. They only care for their income. They only care that they have bread the next morning on the table, and that's it. Well, take away the bread, they will go into revolution, but that's something else.
And a good example of that would be the Third Reich.
Oh, yeah. Good example would be that, with the Enabling Act of 1933.
That's right.
That the Enabling Act is a precursor of the Patriot Act, and the Enabling Act took away the Constitution and took away the control mechanism the Parliament had over the government. And that is exactly the same thing that happened with the Patriot Act in the first step and the abominable, by Obama, pushed through NDAA, National Defense whatever Act.
Yeah, yeah.
No?
Yeah, well, this is important. I mean, a lot of people jump over this, and, you know, in course, it's so predominant today. That's the reason why you see it's no speculation, you know, it's no speculation who runs the United States government today. I mean, it's not even up for debate. I mean, 6 out of the 9 chief justices are Catholics, so they're the ones that are interpreting the Constitution. And then you have every single layperson, every single committee and subcommittee in Congress is chaired by a Catholic layperson.
Yeah, so to understand that, you only have to read the first chapter of Rulers of Evil, Subliminal Rome, all the people are even numbered up. People like in that time, and we're talking about 1992, because that was taken from that political almanac at that time. Even there you have people like the vice president of today, Joe Biden.
Yes, in other words, all foreign policy. I could never understand, and I think every American, you know, all these wars. I'm 71 years old, and I slid under the covers for Vietnam. I got out of the military in 65. But, I mean, I could never understand the Americans' foreign policy until I understood who was running it.
Yeah, when you understand that the American foreign policy is written in Georgetown University, Georgetown University, then you will understand, of course, the foreign policy of the United States of America.
And of course, people that listen to this for the first time, and most people, you know, when we make statements like this, this is to cause people to do their own research. See, to do your own research. In other words, I say this about Rulers of Evil. Rulers of Evil, if you can refute the first chapter, the figures that Tupper Sauce used, you don't have to read the rest of the book. But I'll tell you the theses of his book, the message that he gave. That's the message that's in his book is this, that the American government was Catholic from the very beginning. Boy, whoa, Whoa, Pizzo. Whoa, now both York and Walt, man, you completely jumped off the cliff. But that is reality. That is reality. Now, we still have the Protestant Ten Commandments and the Bill of Rights, and don't ever forget that the people that were in the streets, the heritage of this country, were 99% Protestants. And you see, a Protestant will question. See, the Reformation, when it created Protestantism, it created people that question things. You're not to question anything anymore.
You're not, surely not to question authority.
No. And when you go into a church, this is a good time to read this here. This is on historis.com, and they said this party was right. Many sincere saints have contacted this ministry and expressed their fear and apprehension to even mention in their church fellowship their doubts about the rapture. Some have even been excommunicated and considered as heretics. Stop right there. When he said they've been excommunicated. That's Romanism. You know. And anyway, they wrote this. They said, "My pastor says that there is a rapture before the tribulation, and if I don't believe this his way, I can leave the church. Please help me.
Please leave the church.
I am very well depressed and anxiety ridden, as is my wife. We are so scared of being kicked out of the church if we disagree with the pastor. Our nerves are a jumble every time we listen to him. He sends shivers up our spines. I want the truth. Well, my answer would be to read the Bible, but to understand something, I have a lot of empathy for people because I understand how I came, listen, it's very hard for anybody that's listening to this broadcast right now to say, you know, listen, if you're talking to somebody that came out of a seminary or a Bible college, they are not telling you the whole gospel, okay? And they are teaching that the Roman Catholic Church is just another denomination. And but the reason I brought this up, see, is you're not allowed to question. You can't even question this. And I know this. I would never go into any of these churches and get into any kind of a dialogue. I just wouldn't do it. Because I know, now before I knew some of this information, I used to get into some of these dialogues. But not now. I already know how they think before I even, just like Rick Wiles. I've never met Rick Wiles. I have nothing really against Rick Wiles. But I know how he thinks and where he got his eschatology. Whether he knows it or not, he is teaching Jesuitism.
A lot of people who teach that don't even know that it is Jesuitical.
That's the second thing I want to bring up. We have had so much spiritual exercises, Ignatius spiritual exercises, and spiritual formation and contemplative prayer, and it all comes out of the Roman Catholic Church, okay? We've had so much of it that I feel that some of these men that I've mentioned are controlled and they don't even know it. Yes, that is a fact. With all of this, look at what we have on the internet. You know, I don't watch any news, and I don't pay any attention to what's going on in Israel. I know they're cooking up a war. I know the Vatican's cooking up a war. That's really obvious. But I don't keep focused on this and focused on. I mean, if look at, we've had over 30 gun shootings since Obama was in there, a mass, you know, all this. Listen. I keep it. Every one of us that are in this broadcast, our brothers and sisters. I mean, I got to have empathy for all of us because I have to. I cannot thump anybody because I know where I've been and how I've been ridiculed at times. So I don't have to get into any kind of a debate now with somebody. They have their right to freedom of conscience. You see, when you see somebody that's been a third or fourth generation Catholic, then you have to have empathy for them. You have to realize what they have been through. And for them to step out of Roman Catholicism or step out of one of these ruptured churches, raptured churches, are these churches that speak in tongues? Do you really realize where that came from? You know who started that stuff? It started in a charismatic movement. It was started by the Jesuits. That uttered muttering and speaking where you can't know what they're saying, that's not biblical. That's a demon. Those are demons. If you speak jumble, and speak all this stuff, and I've heard these men say this, and you can't interpret it, if there's not an interpreter for it, it's demonic. I mean, I didn't want to go there, but that's how far this has gone. I don't say anything, and if somebody wants to speak in tongues, that's fine. But don't tell me that I need it, or I'm going to miss the rapture. I have the authority of the Word of God.
You're going to miss what rapture?
Well, that's what they tell you. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're going to miss the rapture.
Okay, I got no problem with that.
But anyway, when I read Luther, we've only read a couple pages, but when you start reading Luther, you realize just nothing's changed except that there's a different definition of stupid. How stupid can people get? What's stupid is the inability to learn, by the way. So I don't cut either. But how far is ignorance? Ignorance is the
unwillingness of learning.
Ignorance is the tool of the papacy. You know, the food of popery is ignorance. Ignorance is the mother of papal devotion. Ignorance is the legitimate prey of popery. Ignorance, the condition of being uneducated, unaware, or uninformed. And see, right now, we have freedom of speech. Now, they haven't put a drone down in any, but I'm going to tell you something, the technology that they got, I am not scared. They can only kill me once. You know, I'm going to squeal like anybody else with some pain. That's going to hurt. It's going to hurt. I hope it's clean. But this, I'll tell you, the more we learn in ways, and I learn from brothers and sisters when I share, you know, I don't get a chance, but every once in a while, you know, I get a few people that call me and I talk to them and I can see what's on their heart. I can hear what's on their heart, and they share their heart when they start seeing some of this stuff. And all the thing I can say to them is this, listen, you're all right. The world is it's insane. And the Bible tells us that the whole world will be deceived. And brothers and sisters, it is here today. The whole world is deceived, falling around a God that's in a bulletproof Pope mobile, claiming to be God, wearing a fish hat and red shoes.
And the whole world wandered after the beast.
And the whole world wandered after the beast. And that's exactly what the whole world is doing right now. Not future. Right now. Today. That's why when people get hooked on this, what's going on in Israel, I mean, when you read when Christ was baptized in the Jordan River, you know, we mentioned this, but I want to mention this. You know, we are told, you know, that the Jews rejected Christ. Not all the Jews. When somebody says the Jews rejected Christ, that is a lie. That's saying that every single Jew rejected Christ. That isn't the truth.
No, it's just the Jews that followed the teachings of the Pharisees and scribes at that time.
That's right.
And who were taught the Talmud instead of the Bible. And in the Talmud, it states what I have told you about the rotting hands and the bones of the arm and the bones of the person who opens the book of Daniel, who will rot in hell, if you want to translate it that way. And that's how they got the people not to accept Jesus Christ, because of their false teaching. The people were as innocent in that time as the people are innocent today. But the problem is, they are given today so much more technology to get to the truth, and they are just too lazy to do that. That is the difference. In the time of Jesus' coming, the people wanted to know the truth, and they relied on what the scribes and Pharisees and the rabbis told them in the synagogues. Of course, because they were trusted. God had set the system up in that way that these priests in the synagogues could be trusted. But they mixed the holy with the profane and gave the Jews not even the possibility to read the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, which was the first book Martin Luther translated when he translated the Old Testament. Yeah, he translated first the New Testament, and after that, the Old Testament, 1535, he started with that. But the first book he translated was the book of Daniel. That's the importance of the book of Daniel, even as it is as important to read in the New Testament, the book of Revelation. So we have come to the end of our show today, on the 6th of August, 2015. We will continue next week our open letter to the Christian nobility, and when you put, instead of Christian nobility, you put the rulers of the world in today, that's exactly how you should see it, an appeal to the ruling class. Then, 500 years ago, and today. This is the reason why we're reading that. So, thank you, Walt, very much for setting up the call and coming to the broadcast and acting as a wonderful co-host next to me. Thanks for all your input. Thank you for all the people that have been listening to the live broadcast and all the people who will watch the video afterwards. And until next time, God bless you all, and bye-bye.
Bye for now. God bless.